Welcome to the expedition. I've been wanting to share this thing with you. It was my dad's. He bought it brand new in 2012. It's fully loaded, $56,000. And I've inherited it. He took delivery in December 2011 in Alaska. I've actually been holding off just a little bit until I could drive this, the fourth generation Expedition, to compare it directly to mine, the third generation. And this truck, this SUV, this giant hulking car, has been in our family since new. It's bombed all over Alaska. It's been north to Denali. It's been south to the Kenai Peninsula. It's been up and down the Alcan Highway four different times, and it's been barged two other times when my dad didn't want to drive it. I call it the hauler. That's the nickname. It hauls everything.
You're watching Everyday Driver. We make a TV show, podcast, and YouTube channels dedicated to great cars, driving adventures, and helping you find a car you'll love. Subscribe and hit the bell so you don't miss a thing.
There is very little this thing can't do. It seats eight very comfortably, and you still have 2 feet of cargo space behind the third row after you pack eight people in here. It's astounding how much space this has. You look over your shoulder and you're still, oh, there's more car behind. Oh yeah, there's more truck way back there. Ford has pretty much always built the Expedition in two different flavors, and it's the wheelbase length. So look at this in comparison to Todd's Lotus. Now, the Lotus is probably among the smallest cars on the road. You could almost park it in the back of this thing. You fold the rear seats down, the second row, you could almost get it in. Comfort is the top priority, and that's why my dad loved this truck. The back seats are okay. You know, everybody's got to get comfortable, and they do recline. But the amount of legroom is not amazing. You'd think there'd be actually more than there is. And interestingly, in 2012, Ford did not offer a telescope feature to the wheel. They only offered the tilt. And what they did instead was an electrically operated pedal set that moved forward and back for the size of the driver. It makes kind of for an awkward seating position, but you can get there. And then once you're settled in, the seats are great, plushy, cushiony, and you just want to settle back and watch the world. My dad never really liked black, and so he ordered burgundy. You could call it old man burgundy, you can call it big red. It kind of looks the, you know, Iron Man look now that it's got the bronze wheels. And he hated the chrome, which I agree, so he had the front grille painted to match the body color, which kind of gives it a customized look. So I took off the roof rack because I can still get the skis, everyone's skis, in the truck, and everybody and their gear. It's really no problem. So the only chrome left on the truck are the door handles. It's not stealth by any stretch, but it kind of has a customized look. These trucks are notorious for the tailgates rusting, and you can see the paint bubbles in various areas. But what's funny is my first car was a 1977 Jeep Cherokee, and I shared it with my sister. It was also burgundy. My dad likes burgundy cars. And so after he bought it, he drove it for a week in Minnesota, and it got, you know, muck and salt all over it. And then he did the underbody coating, thereby sealing in all the salt, and it rusted from the inside out very severely. This kind of continues that tradition in our family. So the rusty tailgate is kind of necessary. I kind of feel better now that it's got some rust bubbles. It feels normal. This is the Triton V8, 5.4 liter V8. It only makes 310 horsepower, and with the mileage on it and the altitude, I bet you it's 250, 260 at best. She'll do 80. I've even had the truck up to 100, I admit, once. There's a lot of wind noise, and it doesn't get great gas mileage. And after driving it for a full year, I'm right in the 13, 14 range, somewhere in there. So in the mountains, it's not great. I want the supercharger for this. I'm thinking, you know, various upgrades as I can get to them. I keep forgetting after driving the Cayman and getting back in the Expedition, what a gigantic SUV this is. And I put Bilsteins all the way around, and it's actually got a stiffer ride, and it kind of holds the road, if you can believe it. On Highway 80, going to Salt Lake, I can actually hang on these corners because of the Bilsteins. It's actually fairly crisp, if you can believe it. The truck has actually kind of come to life in a weird way. If you go back to 2004, that's when Ford started putting independent rear suspension on the Expedition. It predates the Mustang independent rear suspension, and that's the difference in the ride quality. What's also cool is the tow rating on this thing is 9,200 pounds. But 9,200 pounds with independent rear suspension, that's impressive. Taking a moment to switch vehicles and switch weather, the biggest difference with the fourth generation Expedition is the engine. It is now a turbocharged V6. It is the 3.5-liter EcoBoost engine in this, and I know what you're thinking. It's not a V8 and therefore not worthy. This makes 375 horsepower and 470 pound-feet of torque. Again, for reference, my third generation is a V8 with 310 horsepower and 365 pound-feet of torque. Over 100 more pound-feet of torque in this brand new one. I love what the turbo has done to wake this thing up, because even though my Expedition feels smaller on the inside, it drives more sluggishly. The engine makes the weight of this one move. This feels actually nimble. Having a turbo makes everything better about this. Now, by putting this V6 in, Ford has gained miles per gallon. This one claims to get 17 in the city and 22 on the highway. But you're gonna be using the turbo so much, you're gonna be in it. And it no longer matters that trucks this big don't have a V8. Ford has also put in a 10-speed automatic transmission. And now you use a rotary dial to switch into drive. Whereas the gear selector in mine, you still feel that transmission. You're still putting it into gear. This one has disconnected you from that, which takes all of the mechanical interaction and feel out of this truck. It leaves a whole lot more space for stuff. Plus, you still get this huge armrest with a cooler size level of storage space underneath. And what I like the most is the hierarchy of the two knobs, from drive mode being secondary, but putting it in gear, the actual transmission, is the biggest thing you hang on to here. What I've always loved about the Expedition has been the independent rear suspension. For as big and heavy as this is, the ride is fantastic. Other manufacturers are now discovering independent rear suspension in their large 7-passenger, 8-passenger SUVs, which is the game changer. Now, these still tow about the same amount of weight, 9,000 pounds for both Expeditions. But this one has been rated higher for the gross combined vehicle weight. So that is, this full of people and gear and your trailer, whatever you're towing, is now a maximum of 15,300 pounds. Almost 8 tons. That's a lot with independent rear suspension. That's what's always impressed me about this. Now, I am in the regular wheelbase Expedition. Ford is now called the longer version, the Max. You have to have the Max equipped with the heavy-duty trailer towing package, which now includes an ELSD and the bigger radiator and the trailer braking components to be able to do that. You want that Max. If you've got family, you've got a lot of people, but this one still has the same amount of passenger space, even though the rear cargo space is shorter. What's nice about this one is that third row actual human beings can climb back there. You might see parts of the interior that look exactly like they're taken from the F-150, but there are parts on the inside that are distinctly Expedition. There is a sense of solidity and the sense that this is one of the best road trip vehicles ever created. But this one has the Ford Pass Connect Wi-Fi system, which means you can connect 10 devices to the Wi-Fi in this car. And you also have Sync 3, which means Android and Apple CarPlay. How long can your bladder last? Really, that's the only question left. You can use it for kids. You've got a large growing family. That's perfectly fine. This is better if you have more adults. Your kids are larger. This is the one you want. The seats are really quite good, even though they're too wide for me. There's more hip room. There's more headroom. This thing just feels bigger, even though, amazingly, Ford has left this at about 5,800 pounds, same weight as the 2012, and also, it's about the same exterior proportions. The front end on this one doesn't have as much character as the 2012. You look at this and you try to find the eyes of a car in the headlights, you try to find that signature look in the grille. It's very clear, very blocky, very brutalist in the 2012, in the third generation. But in this one, I want more character. I want more of a face on the front, more of a distinctive look rather than just something nebulous. Grill and some lights, and I can't really see a face. Because of the styling, there is a sheet metal return on the bottom edge of the door that curls under and catches your leg. As soon as you get out, it actually catches the meat of your lower leg and tears into you. That needs to change on the next generation Expedition. All these wonderful new things about the Expedition, including better hill descent control, brings us to price. This particular Expedition isn't even the top trim level. This is a limited 4x4 with the FX4 package, which means it's $71,895. That's a lot of money. That's a lot of nice sports cars. And that's a lot of used any other truck. So what's the justification for paying that kind of money? This bulletproof, unbreakable feeling that you've got in your Expedition. With the amount of space, the power, and the build quality, it feels like this thing is worth its price. It is the adventure truck. Family, errands, road trips, towing, doesn't matter. I do feel like this is worth the money. This is definitely an investment, but it has the feeling like it'll last you a long time. I don't need this at this point in my life. I don't need one, but if you're looking for this size, I will highly recommend the next generation Expedition to you. It feels bigger to drive. It's strange getting back in mine. It feels like a car again. If you found this Expedition review and you're looking to buy one used, just change the oil, keep them running, do the things that they need. And this thing, I think, will keep running a long time. I don't need a truck this big, but I love it. I love that it's just so comfortable, and I can surprise people with the way it handles. It doesn't have the latest digital anything, and it's not a digital IP. In 2012, what seemed like modern tech and electric switches seems very basic now. It seems just the rudimentary, the entry level of the entry level, very plasticky, but all right, whatever. There's some utility, but it still looks good. I love my Expedition. What you lose in driving feel, you gain in just road trip comfort. Parking is the worst thing about this car. I don't want to take it shopping, but it's so useful. You can fill it up with all your stuff. When you finally have your parking space and you've managed to squeeze this bad boy in here, the Covercraft sunshade is the thing you need. Keeps her cool. It's like a giant oven.